up on the expenditure side of 8%. We've increased our estimates for revenue based on some grant expenditures that we anticipate to bring that to 7.24%. And the RSSC, which stands for Regional School Service Center or Central Office, is actually down 1.53% on a gross and pretty close on a net expense. So the composite of all three of those budgets, the regional budget is up $709,805 or 4.92%. This actual number hasn't officially been voted on or approved by the Region 1 Board. The last time the Region 1 Board met, we were at 5.55%. The regional board said, we really need to see a budget come in at less than 5%. So the administration, the pupil services director, superintendent, have been working, and one of the areas that we looked at was not filling a retirement in the special education department. So that, there's some salary associated with that, plus an education paraprofessional position that wouldn't get filled. These are regional positions or positions that could be working in one of the seven schools in Region 1. So we got it to 4.92. The Region 1 board has a budget workshop scheduled for Thursday at 7 p.m. at the high school, and they'll hear that officially. We've informed them of that change, and we were going sort of under the directive that they said to get it below 5. But I want to point out that, because officially, if the board came back and said, no, we don't want to make that change, it would go back to where it was, potentially. I don't see that happening. But before we flip to the next page, I want to talk about the $709,000 increase. Health insurance. Health insurance is clearly what is driving not only the regional budget, but the local budgets, the municipal budgets. And we've had an exceptionally difficult year with claims. $429,008 of this budget increase is directly attributed to an increase in health insurance costs. $429,008, or 60% of this number, is health insurance driven. If we were to say we had a flat, we had no increase, no decrease in health insurance, we'd be looking at a 1.95% budget for Region 1 this year. Put this in perspective, last year we had a minus 1.69% increase. A negative increase yielded North Canaan a $270,621 increase in the current years, in the 13-14 budget. So we're not talking about last year, we're here to talk about the proposed budget for 14-15, the 709. And I realize that North Canaan has $320,484 of that increase, and that's on page 6 of this document. We'll get to that shortly. So 45% of the increase in the regional budget is getting picked up by the North Canaan Board of Education budget, therefore the municipal budget, the taxpayers of North Canaan. And we are here realizing that this is on the heels of multiple years of increases, of $200,000, $300,000, $400,000 increases. So I just want you to be able to know that is the district administrator working with the superintendent and the regional board, we're fully aware of the impact that the regional budget has had on North Canaan. As I mentioned, even last year, when we proposed a negative budget, you still were looking at over a $250,000 increase. So we looked at a lot of these initiatives. We looked at new teaching positions that were being requested for intervention. There were three positions on the table for a new intervention, for intervention specialists at the high school to basically help students that are at risk of not achieving goal at the high school level. And the board talked about that at multiple meetings. That position, that request for three positions was reduced to an increase of one position. Essentially, that is the only new position that's being added into this budget. And as I mentioned before, it's being offset by a position in special education as a teaching position, as well as a non-certified position. So from what's new in this budget? I'm telling you that there's one intervention position, and then there's two special education positions that are out of this budget. The other big area that's affecting this budget is in the area, not just insurance, is in the area of special education. We increased two lines in the pupil services budget, the out-of-district tuition outplacements, which are for students that we're not able to service in our district, they require special services, and they usually require related transportation. So they leave our district and they go to a, could be a facility such as CREC. It could be a facility for the blind, for mentally retarded students, disabled students. For once it's determined that we don't have the resources or the ability to service those students internally, we send them out. And in the current year's budget, we have $525,000 budgeted. We service approximately 17 students that fall into one level or another of that $525,000. I can tell you that we have a student that cost us over, in the tuition line alone, over $250,000 of that $525,000. So we budgeted $525,000 this year. We expect to expend $780,000 in that budget line that we have $525,000. Next year, and it's very volatile. When we put our budget together last year, we anticipated $525,000. That's why we put it in. We're going to spend $780,000. So we're using money from elsewhere in our budget. We're using it from grants. We're transferring money from salary lines and health insurance lines and doing everything in our power to cover that overage this year. We're budgeting $675,000 in that out-of-district tuition line next year. And you say, well, how can you spend $780,000 this year and budget $675,000 next year? And our hope is that we have enough money in our budget. It's $675,000 for next year. We realize that we can't just keep adding money to our budget. But we also, we have some of those students that are exiting our, and I should say this, some of those students are exiting those services. They're either reaching the age where they're going to graduate from high school. They're going to leave those services. Sometimes they're temporary, and we hope that they are temporary. They go from there, and they'll come back to the high school. They'll come back into a more traditional plan. And one of the reasons that the high school, I'm sorry, that Pupil Services is looking at this, it's a middle school position to offset some of these costs, is to basically keep some of these students, some of these high outplacement cost students, from going out of district and being able to work with them in our school district. So I'm just trying to give you a little perspective on the numbers that are going into it and North Canaan's share of this increase. So let's continue on, I guess, to page two. I talked about the revenue is increasing at the high school about approximately $100,000. You can see that on page two, agriculture education grant, we budgeted $279,515. The state legislature increased the amount of money that we receive for every student that attends Housatonic that's enrolled in the ag program. And they increased the amount per student. So we are basically taking what we're estimating to receive this year, dollar for dollar, and putting that forward. So obviously, we're also making an assumption that every student, the number of students that we have enrolled in the ag program this year, we're going to have, and according to Mr. Burdick and Ms. Davenport, the department chairs at ag, we expect about the same number of students. So we're increasing that. In the area of pupil services, we've increased that special ed placement and excess cost grant. And I mentioned earlier that that's one of the sources that we're using to cover that excess in tuition. We get a grant from the state of Connecticut. So without getting into all the details, when we have that 250,000 plus student that I mentioned, when the amount goes over 4.5 times our cost per pupil, the state will pay for it. Usually they pay dollar for dollar. So for example, let's say our cost per pupil is $23,000 at the high school, and 4.5 times that amount, and that's a figure, but just say for mathematics sake, it's $100,000. That $250,000 student, the state says, okay, you guys are responsible for the first $100,000, it's $250,000, we're going to pay you $150,000. But then what has happened is the amount of money that the state is paying out to Region 1, to Region 6, Litchfield, Wamogo, wherever, they've run out of money. So they say, we're not going to pay you 100%. Last year they paid 77% or 77 cents on a dollar for that above the 4.5 times. So we have a certain number of students. As I mentioned to you, there were 17. We have three students in our district that qualify for this grant. And we estimate it to be, in the current year, $272,000. Next year we're estimating it a little conservatively, $250,000. So that is still it's an increase from the current year. So those are the increases on the revenue side. Everything else on the revenue side is pretty steady. On page three of the how the high school costs are broken down and assessed to the member towns, North Canaan has 136 students as of October 1st, 2013 at the high school, and that represents 32.381% of the cost. And you can see that that's up from about 31%. So you went up approximately 1.5%. And the total high school, the cost of the high school, went from $9,542,739, the second column from the right, to a little over $10 million, $10,046,000 and change. So you're paying 32.381% of that number, which is $32.53. Before we started this budget process, we sent a document to the Board of Finance, and I think the selectmen and the board chairs. We call it shifted enrollment. And I didn't bring a copy tonight for everybody, but it looks something like this. And basically what it does is it shows if we did nothing to the budget and we merely shifted the percentages based on student enrollment by member town, again, more bad news. North Canaan, before we even started talking about a budget, went up $127,051 based on the fact that, going back to page three, your number of students at the high school went from 128 to 136. So the number increased by 8, but the total number of students at the high school increased only by 7. And I've been here before. For example, last year you went from 128 to 128, and your percent went from 27.8 to 30.99. So you increased by about 3% with having no increase in your enrollment. And you obviously know this, but it's just worth repeating. North Canaan is holding its own with respect to the number of students locally and at the high school. And all the other, and you can see that just by looking, not a lot, but you know, Cornwall dropped, Salisbury dropped significantly, although Sharon was up. So actually, no, I'm sorry. In this year, you went from 413 to 420 resident students. So the actual number actually went up 7. I apologize for that. In the past, you can see that it's been trending down. We started at 626 in the 2005-2006 year, and we've been kind of going down slowly. We're at 460, 413. We anticipate 408 the following October. And we'll talk a little bit about that in this projection sheet that we'll get through later. Just to finish out page three, required by statute in our budget document to show what the cost per student is. Currently, we're $23,106, which was that $9,542 figure divided by 413 students. And now we're proposed at $10,046 divided by 420 students, gets us a number of $23,920 per student at the high school. I'll just keep going along unless somebody has a question now. I'm happy to answer questions as we go or at the end. Page four is the sort of the mechanics of how we break out the pupil services budget. And page five, which you can kind of look at the same time, are the exact same enrollments and percentages. The only numbers that are inserted here differently is that on page four, we're looking at the net cost of the pupil services budget, and on page five, we're looking at the net cost of the RSSC budget. These enrollments are not based on the number of students that attend the high school, but the actual number of students that are at each school in Region 1, including the high school. So the high school gets a share of pupil services and RSSC for allocation purposes. If somebody said, well, what does it cost for the high school? We have to include, based on the number of students that are at the high school, their percentage of the pupil services and RSSC budgets. So in North Canaan's case, you can see that you went from $1,026,000 of the 5,456,630 for pupil services, and now you're at $1,061,026 of the almost $6 million pupil services budget. On page six is just a summary of the numbers that we've spoken about. I put boxes around the high school total, pupil services, and RSSC totals. Because as of now, these are the numbers that we have provided to the elementary and the K-8 schools. So that's what should be in their budget documents. And those are, again, based on the 4.92%. So North Canaan, again, you can see in the lower right, is up 320, 484. We got 295 at the high school, 34, 854 in pupil services, and a reduction of central office of 9870 for a total of 320. I'll go back to some detail of the high school, but I kind of feel like right now is sort of a good time to talk about this document, which isn't necessarily directly related to the proposed budget. Indirectly it is, but I think for the town of North Canaan, as I started by saying, we were in a string of bad years here financially, in terms of what the regional budget, its impact has been on the town of North Canaan. So when we look at actual 11-12, a lot of these numbers and percentages have come right up. We lifted them right from the budget documents. Again, that year you had 127 students of 503. You were at 25% of the high school. If we look, you went from 25 to 27 to almost 31 to 32. Next year we're projecting 34.5. I want to talk to you about how we came up with those numbers. In the following year, looking like it could come to 31.9 and then to 29.2. Next year's percentage is not a guess. Next year's percentage, when we say budget 14-15, it should say proposed budget. We know that the percentage is 32.381 of the high school. That's a given because those are numbers that are based on October 1st, 2013. What isn't a given is the $10,046,225 until the Region 1 puts a number forward to public hearing, which we'd expect to probably do sometime at the end of this month, have a public hearing. I think it's been set for the first Wednesday in April, and then it goes to region-wide referendum the first Tuesday of May. So North Canaan's share is the $3,253,063. That's what we have in the budget document right now. When we talk about going forward and how we came up with the 34.5%, we estimate that there'll be 138 students attending the high school next year out of approximately 400 students that we think will be at the high school in total. So for next year, we do it not very scientifically, but we actually call each elementary school principal's office and speak to the principal and or the secretary, because they tend to know where the eighth graders are applying to go to school for the following year, and we try to get a sense from them. So for example, North Canaan, I believe, has 33 eighth graders. We've got an understanding that a certain number of those students have applied for a private school or Oliver Wolcott. However, just because a student has applied for doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to attend. So we try to look at historical information. We went back and looked at a five-year average and said, okay, because North Canaan's percentage could be a lot different than Sharon's percentage or different than Kent or Salisbury's. Salisbury and Kent tend to send, in some cases, 20 to 25% of their students to a private school. Sharon sends about 98% of their students or 99% to the high school. And North Canaan is sort of a mix in between. It's probably one of our more difficult ones to predict because of Oliver Wolcott. And a lot of the students at Oliver Wolcott for Region 1 have a North Canaan zip code that would come here. So we tried to, again, take our best estimate based on information that we received from the school, plus looking at some historical information, and tried to make an educated guess. We have to do that for every school to come up with a number of 400. We also take the number from NESDEC that they give us for information for the high school. We're not so sure. Their information has been pretty accurate. So we try to basically take all those factors into consideration. But again, that could dramatically change. And I was working with somebody in my office today, Michelle, and she said, well, what if you're off by three students? Well, we just looked at the cost per pupil of about $24,000. So we know we're going to be $75,000 or so one way or the other. So for every student that we're off, we're going to be off by that cost per pupil amount. So again, this is just a forecast. The assumptions are only as good as the information that we can put together. But we wanted to show you that because it looks as though, again, it starts getting fuzzier as we go further off. Our eighth graders, we have a pretty good idea because we can call and we can get some real specific information about each student. But when we start talking about seventh graders and sixth graders, it gets a lot more difficult. The one thing that we did notice in the 2017-18 forecast year, the number of students that you have in the current sixth grade class at North Canaan is 22. Does that sound right? I think so. 22 sixth graders, and the sophomore class of the high school is 38. So no matter sort of what happens there, there's going to be a drop. Now, whether it's that big of a drop or not, we don't know. But, you know, we do see there being a drop, a significant drop, again, 2 years out, or 3 years. Just lost my train of thought about the enrollment projections, but the same applies to pupil services with respect to the number of students that, from this purpose, we just used the NSDEC enrollment projections. They start looking at births, and they start basically, and it's fairly easy because we're also, you know, we can't predict births, of course, so anything beyond a few years is pretty difficult. We start getting beyond five, forget about it, but this is basically taking the number of, you know, young kids and just moving them through and moving out the older kids for the graduates. So the pupil services and RSSC projections are probably a little bit more solid, and we would feel pretty comfortable with those numbers, but again, you can see from where you've been to where this 14 budget gives you, it looks like there's still an increase ahead next year in the neighborhood of $200,000, and then hopefully the following year gets sort of flat, and then maybe there's a drop of about $150,000. So again, you can do what you want with that, but we hope that, it's fairly accurate. The last sheet, we just wanted to kind of talk about, and I didn't want to monopolize the meeting, so I wanted to just kind of go through quickly 14-15 increase breakdown. We talk about the total increase at the high school is up $435,750. Contractual salary increases, and when I say contractual, every salary now at the high school is covered under one collective bargaining agreement or another, whether it's the teachers, the non-certs, or the administration. The health insurance is up $230,539, and all other of the $10,046,000 budget at the high school is up $51,805. There is a significant amount, there's still a $75,000 increase in the high school budget for classroom technology. And the high school budget committee, the board, has looked at this, has heard presentations from the principal, from the department heads, from the IT department about trying to move the high school forward. You heard exactly a year ago, probably over in the elementary school, from Mr. Harnett about bring your own devices and providing one-to-one iPads for every student. The high school has looked in a different direction upon looking at it internally with its staff, with the consultants, etc. And the feeling is that we want to upgrade the computer labs. We have labs that are updated and talked about updating the math department, for example, with laptops because they have more power, they have more ability that they need to use in the math classroom setting. So the idea of providing the iPads that we talked about last year is sort of taking a back door to moving forward with laptops and math and some Chromebooks, and which is a similar type device, tablet device, in the area of social studies and English. And I don't know a whole heck of a lot about the academic side of it, but I did hear the presentations, and I know that the board made a decision to eliminate approximately $70,000 of the increase and said, you know, you've asked for a lot of technology, we'd really like to see you kind of phase it in over a couple of years. So the increase that they received wasn't everything that they asked for, but it was approximately half. In the area of pupil services, that's the total increase, the 458. The salary, similar to the high school contractual increases, are teachers and non-certified. And when I say non-certified, put in perspective, we have we have 50 education paraprofessionals that work district-wide. What they are, they're non-certified people that In some cases, work one-on-one with students. They're required by the student's individualized education plan. It's federal law that they have an IEP for a special education student. It says that, you know, so-and-so student needs to have a one-on-one with him. Our director said that approximately half of our ed pairs are one-on-one, and the other half or 25 are spread out over the 7 schools and work in classrooms and support classroom teachers, support special education teachers and students, again, that are have some sort of disability. So the health insurance increase there is 181. The all other is the 219. I talked about 150,000 of that 219 is directly related to out-of-district tuition, and the majority of the other is the transportation. And you'll hear a little bit about that more, but we our transportation contract was renegotiated. And again, in some cases, we have some extremely expensive tuition or transportation situations. I'll give you one example. A student from Kent will have to go to Creck in Hartford or into Windsor. They take a bus and they drive a student from Kent, Connecticut to Windsor, Connecticut. It cost us over $300 a day for the bus, and we put a individual on the bus, which is again required by the IEP, at a cost of $100 a day to drive a student there, drop them off, and then pick them up at the end of the day and drive them back. So our tuition and kind of goes hand in hand with transportation. So that's where we're seeing a big increase as well. The RSSC budget is actually down $15,952. Salaries are down $37,416, and everybody's kind of scratching their head wondering how that happened. Last year, we had a situation in the office where we made some one-time expenses as part of a settlement agreement with an employee who was in central office, a secretarial position, and as part of the agreement, it was paid through salary. So our salary was sort of artificially inflated last year. It was a one-time expense that's been adjusted down this year. Our health insurance, like everybody else, is up as a percentage of our budget, $17,000, and then all other. We have some additional money in our budget. It's actually $15,000 in our budget, and I'll talk about why we end up with $42.41 there. But we've put money in regionally to support all of the elementary schools, not the high school, but the 6 elementary schools. It made sense for us to regionally look at providing support. PowerSchool is a student database information system that the schools use for everything from tracking cafeteria information, grades, attendance, health records, you name it. Anything that goes with a student today has to be tracked. It has to be reported to the state. It's all required. We made a transition from a system called Rediker to a system called PowerSchool. And like any new technology and system, it requires training. So the best thing that we could do, it was requested to hire an employee. We really didn't want to go out and hire an employee, train an employee, pay benefits on an employee, and then have everybody kind of get up to speed on PowerSchool and then say, okay, now what? Now we pay unemployment on an employee. So we thought the most efficient and effective way to do that was to work with a service, whether it's CREC or it's an independent training company, to come in, provide a certain number of days of service. Those services are usually shared by the schools. We also cut out a little bit of individual time for each school that they, if they have their own specific issues or questions that they can work with this contractor, independent contractor. We haven't determined who that contractor is. We have in the current year, we took some money out of the RSSC budget, teacher professional development line, which we're required to provide. We took $10,000 out in the current year, and we're doing that this year, and that's sort of gotten us over the hump, but we're going to need to continue to fulfill that training need for at least 1 or 2 more years. So that's an increase in our budget. There was a savings, also legal costs has also increased in our budget line. Unfortunately, we have another lawsuit that's sort of pending and out there in our, that our board is addressing or is looking at. So there's increased costs. There's an additional $7,000 in our legal line. And the unemployment cost savings is a reduction. I mentioned before that one-time salary. There was also one-time unemployment cost that we paid in the current budget. As part of that separation of agreement with the employee that I mentioned, there was some costs associated with that related to unemployment. So those costs went into our budget, and they're not in the upcoming budget. So I've said a lot. Hopefully I've covered the highlights of the budget. Again, the board meets on Thursday, potentially would meet maybe one more time if they don't wrap it up on this Thursday. And again, the public hearing, I don't have the exact date, but I think it's Wednesday, April 3rd. It's Wednesday, so Wednesday's the 2nd. Okay. Yes, Wednesday the 2nd. So I don't, Patricia, I don't know if you have anything to add, or Ned, but kind of hit everything, or is there anything you'd like me to cover?
It's just throwing a lot at you guys in a very short period of time, and I could assure you that the board and Ned have worked very, very hard on this budget and had many meetings and continued to work on it, and I think you're well represented at the region.
How many non-certifieds for the special ed do you have? Did you say 50?
I've questioned that myself. It's a big number.
It sounds
really big. And I know when it's broken down and you start breaking it down by mandated requirements and then how many are left and how many are spread out over each school, it doesn't quite seem as big. And
right.
I think everybody would look at the number individually, but if you were to ask Rosemary if she could do with one less or two less ed paras or a special education position, she probably has two or three special education teachers right now in her building. She shares occupational physical therapist. North Canaan does have its own psychologist. There are four elementary schools, the larger ones, have their own psychologist and speech clinician. The smaller schools, Leach, Kellogg, Falls Village, and Cornwall, share those services. So the smaller elementary schools share services like that. Mm-hmm. And everybody shares the occupational and physical therapist positions. I can tell you, and it doesn't necessarily have anything to do with the budget, we have a position we've been trying to fill for a year and a half for a speech clinician. Sometimes these positions are extremely hard to come by. The services, again, are required. So if we're unfortunate and not able to fill a position, we end up hiring an independent contractor. And I can assure you that in terms of the best bang for your buck, if you're able to hire somebody and put them on the teacher salary schedule, it's a lot more cost effective. Because what ends up happening when we hire a service, the hourly rates are so high, it includes usually travel time out to our area of the state. And they usually charge for travel. And as soon as we start trying to negotiate, it doesn't really go very well.
Right.
Because they're in such high demand. Speaking of negotiating and contracts, I mentioned before, this is more of an elementary school thing, but I was unfortunately or fortunately, however you want to look at it, charged with negotiating a regional bus contract. And I know that you'll see in Rosemary's budget later on, I think there's an increase of around $16,000 on her bottom line for transportation. And we worked with our current contractor, which we're very happy with. It's All Star Transportation. They've been working in Region 1 for a very long time, formerly DU4. Transportation. And we basically sat down, we worked with a consultant, we hired somebody, and they never billed us, so that was great. We just made a few phone calls and had some conversation with him. The last time we worked with our consultant, we actually hired him to help us kind of redraft our contract, and just to go through and make sure that everything was up to speed, everything was up to current standard, etc. So we called him, and we said to him, we're in the midst of negotiating a new contract. Any suggestions? And he asked, well, what competition has come in place in Region 1 since the last time we spoke 4.5 years ago? And we said, well, there really isn't. And he asked what the contractor was requesting, and we said 20% over 5 years. And he thought about it, and he called us back a few days later, and he said, that's pretty reasonable given X, Y, and Z, the different mandates in terms of bus equipment and safety and emissions, et cetera, training for drivers. And we went back to the bus vendor. We said to them, it's really steep. We showed what the impact would be. And he agreed to lower it to 17.8% over 5 years, but did ask to front load it. He wanted to get to where he needed to get to sooner, and so he asked for a 6.5% increase in the current year, and that was sort of in exchange for accepting a 17.8 rather than a 20. So when we looked at it, we know we're going to need buses. In North Canaan, you have 5 buses. At the end of the contract, if we took the plan of front loading it at 6.5 in the first year, by the time we got to the end, under that situation, it was still paying less than it was if we spread it out 20 over 5 years. So unfortunately, we don't have competition, and there's not anybody else that's knocking on our door. You know, we made some inquiries and we talked to the competition. They don't have a bus, a way to put a facility in place up here, and it just didn't work. So unfortunately, we live in a beautiful part of the country. We're very fortunate. We have an outstanding bus company. You know, every bus company, occasionally you read something in the paper, you know, something happened, somebody was returned to the school or whatever, but we are very, very fortunate when we put our kids, our students on these buses, to know that they're in good hands. So that's one thing. And the last thing I just want to close with is back to the health insurance, because I have talked to Mr. Humes, I've talked to the other selectmen in Region 1. If there was any way we could be with a different carrier, with a different plan to save money and prevent us from having to deliver budgets that are 60% driven by health insurance, we would be there. We went out to bid. We, in our current carrier right now with Aetna, we switched from Aetna in 4 years ago. We saved $460,000 by switching. We waived that in front of Anthem, and they were willing to come down some, but nowhere near it. We saved $460,000. We switched. Our average over the last 3 years has been 6.7%. The current year that we're in, our claims are running at 110% of our premium collected. So for every dollar that we're paying Aetna in premium, they're paying out $110 in claims. In the last 2 months, the last month, November, the claims were 120%. So for every dollar that they collected, they were paying out $120 in that month. That month was not considered in the quote that was given to us by 2 other carriers in the state of Connecticut. There's basically 4 carriers in the state of Connecticut, Aetna being one. 2 others bid on us, and the other, we provided the claim information, didn't even bother giving us a quote. The 2 that gave us a quote before the 120 was factored in for the month of November were both in the 30% range. Aetna came back at 46.1%, met with us, and said, we didn't even say anything. They said, we know we can't give you a 46.1% renewal because you will walk. We're going to negotiate with you. We went back and forth. We waited for another month of claims to come in. It was that 120. They said the best, absolute best that we will do is 22.9%. We want to retain Region 1's business. We were the first public sector school to move to Aetna. They want to be able to use us as a reference. They want to be able to say that we've been with them for 4 years. They don't want us to leave, go somewhere else, save a little bit of money, and then lose us as a client. They lost over $700,000 in the current year on our account. Even at 22.9%, they are not buying it back. If they were, we would be switching to somebody else and we'd be getting a renewal less than 22.9. I feel terrible. I work with it. I work with them every almost day. I deal with some issue of insurance one way or the other. We've worked with our school boards. We've worked with our towns about plan design changes. In some cases, there probably are some things that could still be done potentially. But I can't honestly sit here and tell you that, you know, if we switch to a different company, we could save some money. You know, if we were in a situation where we could save $50,000, we'd have to make that decision about whether it would be worth it to transition our 35 some odd groups that we have over to them. But we don't even have that choice. So I don't know really what else to say.
I'd also add that some of the Affordable Health Care Act is factored into that as well, and all of the insurance companies are doing that.
Yes, this government stuff.
Right.
That's a good point.
Anybody
have
anything?
Nothing?
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Do you want the chair or do you want to stand?
The hot seat?
Okay, it's on.
The hot seat.
And I do come to you tonight with a bit of a heavy heart in that our past 5 years have been, we've been locally at zero or below. And I'm going to start by saying before I put a piece of paper in hand that there is an increase. And I want to give you some information and then I will show you what. The first paper is the per pupil cost in Region 1, which I think is important for you to know exactly what it is. Because in the budget preparation, and I know that the board works very hard to produce a responsible budget every year, as do I, and wanted to look at the per pupil cost because wanted to see where, if we were in line or if we were trending upward, because there is an increase. And you'll see that the net current expenditure per student is $15,862. And you can compare that to the other towns in the region. With that being said, and I don't think I've produced enough copies for everyone, I'm going to give you a little history over the past 5 years to show you that we have saved some dollars. And it's a little chart that shows you what's been budgeted and what the increases or decreases have been over a five-year period. And if you look on page 2, you will see at the bottom there an amount. So if we're starting from a lower position, because if we had 5 years ago to increase at roughly 2%, we'd be starting with a much greater figure now this year than we would have. So with that being said, I'm going to tell you that our local Board of Education increase is 5.7% of this draft. And this is a draft. So if we start with the back figure, if you flip over to the last page, which is page 8, you'll see the bottom line, and you probably want to start with the bottom line and work your way back. Because that's really, the bottom line is what interests people, I think. And if you take a look at it, you can see what it is. So the overall budget increase for the town of North Canaan, when you factor in the Region 1 budget, is 6.7%. And I would say that out of that, we have about 5.25% of that is costs that are passed on to us, out of that 5.25% out of that is passed on to us. So if we look over to page 1, and you kind of have to flip back and forth until you get past this first page, you'll see that we've outlined the first is the teacher salary line, which has an increase. And you'll see in the description there, the board settled with the teachers on a new 4-year contract. In year 1, which will be next year, all teachers will move to the next step at mid-year. And the step means if you think, I think we've talked about this before, is a chart with 12 rows. We have a 12-step salary schedule, and then you go across for the degree. So the first column would be a BA, because that's a minimum requirement for a teacher, then an MA, then a sixth year, and then a doctorate. So if you're hired at step one, usually it's an MA or a BA. It could be an MA as well. So teachers move down through those steps, or really up to step 12. 12 is the highest step that we have. But they can also move this way if their degree changes. And some are working on that. Every year we take a poll and we find out for budget purposes who's working on what, and the superintendent has to approve a program. The teacher couldn't say, well, I think I'd like to take a course in basket weaving. Will you pay for that? No. It has to be a program, and the superintendent signs off on that. So you'll see in that description there, it tells you what will happen in the 4 years of that contract. In year two, teachers will remain on the same step. In year three, they'll move a step, but they'll do it at mid-year. And in year four, there'll be no step movement. And our calendar will be aligned with Region 1 for the length of this contract. So we don't have an extra day built in there with extra cost. If you look down, you'll see the North Canaan faculty is made up of the breakdown of the BA, MA, etc. That substitute teacher line, substitute pay, next year will go to $85 a day. We also take an average in there for a nurse substitute. We do hire a nurse when the regular nurse is out. And you can see we have a retirement incentive. We have one incentive ending this year. In this budget year, and then we will be in year two of a 3-year incentive. If you jump down on page one on the accounting sheet, you'll see that it's pretty much all zeros, because the non-certified contract will be negotiated this spring and summer. And work on that has just begun. Anybody with a question on page one? And page two, you should be able to lay flat on the table and see the description. And as Sam told you in the Region 1 budget presentation, there is a 22.9% increase, which translates, the number on that line says 43%, and you might be wondering why that is. It is a combination of the premium increase plus the needs of the staff. So you have people moving from single to double to family, etc. Teachers will pay 13% of the premium cost, and that's up 1% over this year. We have not because the contract's under negotiation, we don't have a number there yet for the non-certified. If we go down to the big item on that page, the other big item aside from the health insurance, is our workman's comp. And this increase reflects a one-time expense from a prior carrier, Murma, you're familiar with. And the writing off of existing claims and the writing off of any future liability. And that is a big increase. And I don't know if, Sam, that will continue to increase or that will drop off.
One time.
As a one-time. So that insurance line we should expect in the future to go down, which is, but that's, it explains for you how we arrived at that. And it's not just based on our claims, it's a giant pool. On page 3, you will see that the descriptions on the left, everything is pretty much around zero on this page. There is a bit of a bump in the technical support service line about halfway down the page. And we are building in some dollars for work on power school, the training, and some anticipated switch work that will be coming up this summer. But our system is in pretty good shape. We have maintained it and enhanced it slowly each year, so we don't have any big items. And as the description tells you, we use this technical assistant for anything that's beyond our capability at the school. On page 4, it's pretty flat. We do have a little bit of an increase in electricity, a 2.5% increase budgeted for next year. I'll give you a moment to look that over and to look at the writing on the narrative on the side so that if you have any questions. I would add that the building is in great shape. It is well maintained, and we appreciate that. And thank you. It is a beautiful place to work, and it is very, very well maintained. We keep up. We have a regular schedule for painting, updating, and we keep at that. And that will benefit you as a community in the future, because you won't end up with big projects or looking to fix things or update things all at once. We are budgeting some money to update our science lab, and that is, some of that work will be done this summer to match those 21st century skills. The science lab that was put on in the 70s, and some of you may have been students there with Mr. Glennon, and that science lab. Well, it still looks the same. So we're going to redesign a little bit, reconfigure. We use a smart board in there. We don't use the gas anymore. That's been shut off for many years. So we have to do a little bit of work in there to update it, make it look like we're in the 21st century there. And we're doing that creatively and slowly. And Les is a great resource, and he does a lot of the work himself. If we flip over to the next page, page 5, Sam has talked about the increase in the transportation, and you'll see that reflected on the bus line, which represents the $16,382. And that percent will go down, as Sam said, that was the agreement that he front-loaded. We don't have a lock-in yet on the fuel, and we have budgeted $3.50 a gallon for the diesel. We use about 8,900 gallons for our buses a year. You'll see the insurance figure. Even though postage rates have gone up in the next category down there, we are not increasing postage because we do a lot of our communication electronically. Summer school will continue as the skills program, and it'll be held in Cornwall, and we do provide busing to that, and that takes place in the month of July. We anticipate about 20 students benefiting from the summer school program. On our testing line, we'll be moving from CMTs, as you probably know, although tomorrow our students are taking the science CMT in fifth grade and eighth grade. There is no science testing per se in the new Smarter Balanced testing, which students are going to pilot. It'll be a field test, and that's coming up. Our window for that is April 28th to May 16th. All students will do it, and it must be done on a computer. So all students in grades 3 through 8 will be participating in that. And it's long. It's about 7 hours of testing.
Wow. For a third grader?
Mm-hmm. Not all at once, of course, but spread out over a few weeks. It will be in the future adapted, but it won't be this time because this is how they will make it adaptive. They'll test these questions. They're testing the test, actually. And we will be reworking our schedule a bit to accommodate the testing and to give students kind of an easier time after the test fatigue. And our teachers have some fun activities planned as well as some interesting projects for them. So you will see a different schedule. The Smarter Balanced testing is aligned to the Common Core standards. I'm sure you've heard a lot about Common Core in the news lately. And it's just that standard. It's not a curriculum. There's no prescribed textbook. It's a list of what students should be able to do and know at each grade level in language arts and math. We also have some regional assessments that we participate in, and then we use a number of assessments in our building to get a gauge where students are and to intervene for those people who aren't meeting the expectation. So we keep that testing line is at 0 in place this time. On page 6, we've added some to our supply line because that's the area we've kept low traditionally over the last 5 years, and even though we haven't increased it, goods and shipping costs have continued to increase. So we've added something to that instructional supply line.
Are there specific items that you're anticipating purchasing there, or is that just a general overall 10% increase? Like, are there certain textbooks?
Yes, there are. And if we take a look at the supplies that teachers, what happens in the winter, and it starts in December, is we ask teachers to forecast their needs for the following year. And they each submit a budget, and then we take those numbers and add them up.
Because when you say supplies, I read over here, you know, I'm thinking paper and pencil. That's a lot mm-hmm. of paper and pencils. That's why I was asking, is it specific, like, you know, are we looking at, you know, textbooks, which obviously are larger items, mm-hmm. larger costs?
Textbook has it. The textbooks have their own line down below in 641. But it would be any kind of supply that a teacher needs for their programming. So, for instance, it could be supplies for the science room for science experiments. It could be workbooks for a math class.
So this has been a general increase. Yes. There's not specific items identified.
There aren't
in this
any
5,
new
000.
Big.
Okay. That's what I was getting at. So it's just a general increase.
Mm-hmm. Scholastic magazines would fall in that category. Sheet music for the music department. Anything that a teacher would need to support their program pretty much goes on that line. That's probably our heaviest budget line. It's the most active one, I should say. We do keep have to keep up and comply with copyright laws, so we have to renew licenses annually. Power School, interestingly, is cheaper than Redeker because it's a per pupil cost rather than renewing the program. So it is, that's factored into the software and license line as well. And you can see from there, there is a list of what we use. If we jump down to textbooks, are made up of replacements and new textbooks. And we are moving to a reading series in grade one next year, so we've budgeted for that. If we back up to the heating, there is not yet a lock-in price. We've had a heavy winter, and we are at 22,000 gallons of use. We budgeted for 22,000 next year. We hope next winter won't be as hard as this one. And Sam has recommended 350 per gallon, and that lock-in can come at any time. So we would change those numbers once we get that information.
Have you noted any savings between new windows and everything?
Yes. Yeah. We're down, yeah, it's very comfortable, and we were using 42,000 gallons, so we would be, if we had to use this figure and order 42,000 gallons, that number that's on that 77,000 would be up around 147. So we have saved a significant amount of money with both the heated conversion and the windows. It does make a big difference. It also makes a difference in terms of the electricity, because in the summer there are a few areas in the school that are air conditioned, and those windows help prevent some of that heat, so the air conditioning is running less. It has been a big difference. I'll give you a moment to skim the rest of that.
And the electric company indicated they were going to increase rates.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So they did.
Yep. If you move over to page 7, instructional purchases, where we use mainly to update. We might use that part of that for our science lab. We aren't anticipating any maintenance purchases. That's still on there from the purchase of a machine for doing the floors. So the board is committed to adding some money into a line that we call in school safety to update cameras and locks and any new features security-wise that we may add, or any programming for school safety. We continue with a schedule of technology purchases, replacement, and we have a tiered system for computers. We start in the computer room, and then we go to the library, and then we phase them into the classroom. So we're constantly rotating. The average life of a computer at North Canaan is about 7 years. So we make some purchases, and we do have laptop carts. It's not just for the computer room, but we do make heavy use of laptop carts. We are looking at Chromebooks, a cart of those that could stay in the middle school next year. They are a very cost-effective way for teachers to introduce technology, and it's good for students to have a variety, and it requires teachers to look at it a different way. And it not only is savings with the machine, but in paper. we have the fifth and sixth grade team make heavy use of the Google Apps for Education. We do use Google Apps for Education throughout the school, but they make heavy use of it. They do a lot of projects through Google Drive, so the document is never actually printed. They email assignments to their teachers, and they get feedback electronically. So it reduces the amount of paper. We're always happy to see that as well. We do have to submit a five-year technology plan to the state, which we did last year. That includes a vision for integrating technology into our curriculum, and that helps us focus, and that's the start of our plan. We begin with that, and then we branch out. We're always looking at new things that are out there, new ways of engaging students, and we it's a fact that students will use technology as they enter the workplace. They're required to be comfortable with it by the time they reach high school, no matter what high school they go to. And they are very much in tune to it. You can watch a computer class of kindergarten students log on to a computer and do all kinds of interesting programs. They can draw on the computer, they write on the computer, they read on the computer, and they're very comfortable with it in a way that those of us who are my age, you know, we tend to approach it a little differently.
Just a couple of questions, if you don't mind. And it might just be an oversight one way or the other, but there is a note on the first page that about an increase in the board clerk salary, but I don't know a board clerk salary increase, so is it an old note, or should there be an increase on the board?
There may be an increase on there. We're still working on that line.
Oh, okay. And then as far as, I know the high school has other budget workshops planned. Is this pretty much what you're expecting, except for the fuel costs that are obviously variable? Or is there more, are you still working? Is this still a work in process, or are you guys done as far as you're concerned?
It's still a work in progress. It's still a draft, and we still consider it a draft. And we will, the next time we update, we will bring it to a hearing. This is about what I believe the highest it can be. So you shouldn't see anything increase beyond 5.7. And we work to bring that a little bit lower. We still have a few things that we have to include in there. And we do have a couple of placeholders in there for the contract negotiation. So even though the contract isn't settled.
And when's that supposed to be? And when's that done? Over the summer?
The work has begun now.
Right.
And there is no end.
Mm-hmm. But the expectation, I mean.
We'd like it done by June.
Okay. First meeting is Thursday.
Yes.
Okay. That's what I meant, the time frame in which you're working in.
Mm-hmm. The teacher one has a strict timeline.
Mm-hmm.
But the non-certified, there is no timeline. So in 1 year, we didn't settle until October. We hope to be done well before then.
Yeah. And obviously that ends up being a retro.
Mm-hmm.
So
these salaries that are the current salaries will take us up through June 30th.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.